announcement. I had posted and advertised myself and Mike Exler, who's back there, that we were going to do a combined broadcast from the lobby this evening around 10 p.m. Well, my producer, Todd Sheets, just called me and says, gee, we're having server problems. Well, guess what? Server problems ain't going to stop us from showing the world what a great fucking show this is.
Yeah.
So, at 10 o'clock tonight, myself and Mike will be out there with video cameras. Or we're going to videotape whatever you guys want to say into the camera, walking by, drunk and incoherent, mumbling, whatever the fuck you want to do. We're going to post it on YouTube to tell these people that this is the best goddamn show, not convention, show there is to go to. So that's all about that. Now, I've been telling a lot of people that I'm not going to be vending after this show, which is pretty much true because, for those of you who don't know, I hit a milestone 2 weeks ago. I did something I never thought I would do. I actually reached 60 years old. And in reaching 60 years old, I had an inventory of my body, which I've completely fucking abused for 60 years. And a lot of my, I'm good, I'm loaded here. I'm incognito, I can go on an airplane with this shit. You know? But my attitude right now is I will have some stuff up there. I may be bringing the more horror than horror guys in next show. But if my career is ever going to end, it's going to end right the fuck here at Cinema Wasteland. So you guys are stuck with me till I keel over and die. So. Of course, Ken's stuck with me because I actually moved 3 blocks from his house.
Yeah, I hope he really doesn't die because I'll probably have to bury him.
I don't like the body.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's true.
I can only imagine where you're going to bury me.
Back to your fucking house. I ain't spending any money.
You'll have to dig through a lot of piles of dog shit to do that right now.
Well, that's because some donor doesn't. You need to go. The first thing I need to buy is a small shovel.
I got a big shovel. She's a big shovel.
Trowel.
Trowel, yes, a trowel.
Half elephant by the look of that crap.
Oh, and I will have 2 DVDs coming out shortly. We had a printing problem. We have the Corrupt Desires collections coming out. And since you people demanded it, and I do listen to my fans, John Holmes Part 2. 3 wonderful John Holmes films for your enjoyment.
Is Ed Dunko on this panel?
He's bringing Sharon over.
Oh, okay.
I had to give him some duties.
It just looks so creepy with 3 guys and 1 porn queen unless we're filming it.
Well, you know something? I don't think anybody would be averse to that.
Nah, I just can't see. I got too many people on one panel. So I'm sitting over here. I'm doing the old podium cam again.
I'm sure you'll kick in some pertinent.
Well, I might have something completely worthless to say, and I'll be damned if I won't say it because I get a mic.
Yeah, a mic in our hand is a dangerous weapon.
It is. Well, it can be.
We got an old buddy of ours, actually, who made the trip from a Philly. Is Corey out there? Where's Corey? Was it worth the ride, dude?
Yep.
All right, there you have it. 7-hour ride from Philly to come and see Cinema Wasteland.
We've actually got a lot of newbies. Right? You know, we heard from a lot of regulars that said, oh, I'll do it. I got to work. I got to do this. I can't make it. And, like, I keep running into people all the time. Says, this is my first show. So I'm like, thanks, because attendance is fine. And we like fresh meat. Well, we like it most because, like, if you've ever been to another convention, welcome to the show. And we tend to generally take a newbie and turn him into a family member before long. So we hope you're all having a great time this weekend. Well, it really is a fan show. I always call Cinema Wasteland a fan show, and I run it for you. You guys all know you can email me. You can walk up to me. You can tell me what you want, what you like, what you don't like, who you want to see, and I listen. I think that's the difference between me and a lot of other promoters is I actually listen. I don't my ego isn't so big I trip over it. My belly is, but my ego isn't. So,
well, I got to thank you, too, because being that you invited me to the show, and I don't know how many shows I have been to, you've allowed me to, quote, creatively spread my little furry wings into a bunch of shit that I wouldn't have been able to do anywhere else. So, thank you.
We enable.
You know, enable my bad habits.
Do you remember when you started?
Remember when I started?
Or how you got here? How did you guys wind up?
I've known him for like over 20 years. We met down at the old Chiller Theater. We were smoking cigarettes on the loading dock.
Yeah, we went to the smoking lounge outside the college in one of the first, or maybe the third Chiller Theater show.
Yeah.
And have you always been from here and he was in New York at the time?
Or? Yeah. We just hook up when we run into each other in New York. We did Chiller for 16 years, twice a year, and we'd see him when we were in that area, and we'd just kind of hang out. And then I would go down, he worked for New York Liquidators for Norm, and Norm would say, hey,
You guys, anything you want, $5. And people would be saying, anything you want, $3. Come see me first.
Yeah, it was all fun. I get skids of DVDs and tapes, and I call up Ken, and I go, clean out your driveway, clean out your garage, you got a ton of shit coming.
He was one of them guys, still to this day, I know a lot of guys from those years, and when stuff goes on out of print moratorium, you're not really supposed to sell it, so I get calls going, would you like some assorted horror title?
What happened to Sharon?
Coming.
She's coming?
I'll get her.
Okay. Somebody's waving to me from the back. And what do you mean, she's coming all by herself? Well, I know she comes all by herself and beside the yeah. You're going to get her now?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to
go right away. Andale, andale. Arriba. Ed Demko, porn star wrangler, film 11.
Yeah, other than that, you guys just keep, you know, this is your show. Yeah, it's not really my show. I just pay the bill. You know what I like about it is everybody thinks a convention promoter gets, we make money at this. Here's the funniest thing. Have you ever seen a safety deposit box full of cash? When I pay the bill, the rest fits in my pocket. Not pockets. Pocket. So I wouldn't do this if you expect to make money. If you just want to pay the bill and make a lot of people happy, then you can do this.
And if you guys, you know, a lot of you guys have heard other talks we've done, and you know other panels we've done and shit. Is anything specific you ever want to hear or talk about? You know, we got between me and Ken, we got fucking years worth of stories, grindhouse stories, driving stories. Of course, you guys love my hooker stories. I am exclusive to Cinema Wasteland. I don't do Horror Hound. I don't do bubblegum shows. I do Cinema Wasteland. We don't even bring that up here, sir. There's no point. There's no point. We're here to have fun, not talk about douchebags.
I'm sorry. Did we get a round of applause?
I was having a... We want to know why I don't go to Horror Hound, and I say, I don't do bubblegum shows. We're here to have fun, not talk about douchebags.
Nah, well, we're not here to talk about other shows either. We're here to talk about Wasteland.
Adult film legend, and I just can't say enough about her, and she's a fellow Jersey girl, Sharon Mitchell. And of course, the luscious Ed Demko. So how do you like Wasteland so far?
I love it. Am I on?
Okay.
Yep.
I'm having a great time. This is my first Wasteland, and thank you so much, especially to Eric from Hollywood Book and Poster for sponsoring me here, and I'm just having a fucking blast. Thank you for having me. I think the first convention I've done in probably 19 years. I retired from the adult industry in 1996 to continue my education to be of service to the adult industry and myself. I was running out of money. I said, wow, either I got to marry a rich guy or do Granny Does Vegas. So better get an education.
Well, I guess the opening question, what got you into the business to begin with?
I think it was the best way to say fuck you to the Catholic Church and my parents at the same time. I was a very rebellious child. First, I think humor, I liked attention. I was adopted from an orphanage, and I always kind of felt less than. I was always sort of the redheaded stepchild, so to speak, even though my pubic hair really is, well, it's gray now, but it was brown. I found humor to be a form of attention, and then I discovered sex. I don't know. You know, it's very odd. I had an agent named Dorothy Palmer. I was working for ABC on a soap opera called The Edge of Night.
Oh,
yeah. Yep. Yes. Yeah. Dun, dun, dun. Yeah. Right, yes. And I was Jinxie's private nurse. And I met a gentleman who played the cop, whose name was Wade Nichols, who was also in adult entertainment. And he and I got chatting one day, and then we were at a casting call at Dorothy's, and she said, I could make you guys some extra money. But you have to, be naked and, it's a sex movie, but you'd be the star. And we heard, star? we could be the star of a movie. And back then it was 1975, late 1975, early 1976. And the industry was pretty much run by the mafia back then, which was really neat and nice and tidy. There were about 30 of us that worked in the industry. A handful of girls, a handful of guys, Vanessa Del Rio, Jamie Gillis, Wade Nichols, John Leslie, all our old buddies. And I'll never forget my first movie. I didn't have to audition for it. I kind of showed up and they asked me to take my clothes off and turn around. And they said, okay, you're hired. And I worked with this gentleman, Bobby Astor, who was a jazz drummer. He was a great guy. He was just a wonderful guy. And he was laying down, and I was on top of him, and I was fucking him. And the director said, okay, say something dirty. And being the Catholic girl that I was, I really didn't have a lot of vocabulary in my head, so I went, Oh, baby, come inside me. And they went, cut, cut, cut. What the fuck is this? This is a porn movie. We come outside, not inside. So I was like, okay. Say something dirty. So I said, oh, baby, come in my hand. And I hopped off of him and I put out my hand. And he came in my hand. And I lived in New York City on Downing Street at the time. And there was a little park on the corner, and I think to this day the graffiti is still there, come in my hand park. My friends never let me live that down. Or up.
Well, here's something, the weird segue. You're a Jersey girl.
I'm a Jersey girl.
Carter Stevens and I went almost to the same high school in the same town, so you think there's something in the water there that breeds people?
I think so. Carter Stevens took me under his wing and helped me. I worked at his studio on 29th Street. 29th Street, 226 West 29th Street, I remember it. And he had a girlfriend named Renee that had three nipples.
Okay.
And that, it was...
Was that on one breast?
Yes. No. Two nipples on one and one on the other. Yeah, three together. So I had quite an introduction to the industry. You can imagine. I was with the likes of Gloria Leonard and Vanessa Del Rio, as I mentioned earlier, Marilyn Chambers, Marlena Willoughby, and some other chick who, if anybody can remember this chick, she had long, long red hair, gigantic red bush, and she used to scream when she would come like, and you never knew whether you were hurting her or making her come. It was like terrifying, this woman. But I think her name began with an L, Lorraine something, whatever. Anyway, it was just a cornucopia of characters. And I was hooked. I was like, I'm in. This is great. And Marilyn and Gloria and Vanessa took me shopping on St. Mark's Place. Yeah, trash and vaudeville, and they said, you look like a kid from Jersey. I'm like, I am a kid from Jersey. They're like, you need a haircut, you need to get some hip clothes. So it was just great. It was just a wonderful time in my life. And I met friends that I've had for, upwards of 30 years. The industry had always been very good to me. I have to explain something about the industry at that time, because it was run by the mob, which is no secret. They owned all of the drive-in theaters throughout the United States, as well as all the adult movie theaters. And at that time, there was no video. By cracking, you had to actually walk into an actual theater to, see a movie. And so things were very, very creative and very high budget. You got paid very, very well. You didn't have to do anything you didn't want to do. And you could make a list of people you would work with and wouldn't work with. Every once in a while, they try to throw in a new guy or girl, and you know, we'd either go, yeah or nah. You know, I think I broke in Jerry Butler.
I'm sort of turned on to business real quick.
Yeah, well, you know.
He wrote a tell-all book, for those of you who don't know, that was very flattering to a lot of people.
And it was just about Lois Ayer's pussy smelling like the bottom of a birdcage or something. I think that was the only disparaging one. Which actually, as much as I love Lois, it was pretty accurate.
Well, summer's even. Yeah, got one word for it, massive.
It was accurate, so, you know. And I think he's a postman now in Queens somewhere.
You were involved in one of probably the most notorious ruffies ever made, Taming a Rebecca, which was
nice.
An Avon film.
Yes.
Everybody out here just loves.
Oh, Taming a Rebecca, awesome. We found this wonderful little girl. And I don't remember if she ever did another movie, the young lady.
Velvet Summers?
Yeah, Velvet. Thank
I think
you.
She did two more.
Yeah, perhaps. But at the time, I was working as a dominatrix. I was working at a place called Belle du Jour, which was a very, very exclusive place for a lot of politicians, movie stars, rock and roll stars, and my neighbor, who I had been fucking, this beautiful girl named Nadine, said, oh, why don't you come to work with me one day? And I was amazed. I had never seen anything like this. I mean, it was just a gigantic loft. It had, you know, a bag full of feces, you know, with a guy rolling around in it. It had like a throne with, you know, people peeing on somebody. It had the rack, the bastionado. It had every possible, you know, British invention for torture. and Spanish Inquisition. It had the whole cage, you know, the cage, the whole thing. And Belle du Jour, now, don't you think of, like, Barbarella or something? Out walks this little Jewish chick with a lisp in fucking army boots. So, you want to work here, do you? She says, I'm Belle du Jour. Nice to meet you. I was like, okay, yeah. She goes, well, you got to go through, like, a couple weeks of training, and you got to get your ass kicked, because if you kick somebody's ass, you know, you can't hit him in the kidney or something. You know what I mean? I said, yeah. Which I didn't know what the hell she meant. I said, oh, yes, I understand. So I went through this whole training for 2 weeks of learning how to lace dicks up and pierce nipples and all that goes with the B&D and S&M scene, including speed enemas, wine enemas, coffee enemas. I had an assistant whose name was Nora, who had a dick bigger than she could pole vault across the fucking city. She was a tranny, but just gigantically hung. Amazing. Tits and a cock. It was like fabulous. And she was I was her trainee. And so when I did the movie Taming of Rebecca, I had no problem sticking that safety pin in that girl's nipple. It was fabulous. Velvet's nipple. It was great.
One of the things I was...
That was the real deal. Yes.
I've heard that. I was curious if it was true. But
oh, yeah.
What was Phil Prince like?
Fucking lunatic. Phil Prince was... you have to remember, this was now the late 70s, and we were getting pure cocaine from, Bolivia and Peru. And Phil just loved to get jacked up, you know. So he would be very expressive, and he'd go, yeah, anything goes. And, you know, we were rather ill experience, so we were just okay, whatever you say. So I stuck a gigantic safety pin through her nipple and other parts of her body, I think, at some point. Just, maybe off camera.
Just out of curiosity, what was the reaction like to, like, that movie, for example, even from fans or just from other people in the business? To you or...
I think people were a little shocked, but I was always up for the new and different. You know, I was always the one that, Mikey will eat it. You know what I mean? Mitch will do it. She'll do it. And so long as it wasn't... there were a couple things that were sacred. My good lingerie, champagne, and my asshole. I never did anal sex for some reason. I just figured I had to save something for somebody just in case there was going to be a special moment in my life. So I never did anything I didn't want to do, but that was a little bit, you know, it was a little bit shocking. But then you have to remember that, you know, we were going to S&M clubs at night. There was Plato's Retreat that was going on, and they had hired Joanna Storm and I every Saturday night to do performances there. And we were like, you know, we were like switchblades out and like cut each other's clothes off. And, you know, I mean, everything was nasty. It was raw. It was real. It was the real deal back then. And it was a privilege to be part of the real deal. Just cut to just the last few years. It's been odd coming from such an artistic place with such artistic people and portraying and rehearsing and doing all the great artistic stuff that we used to do because we were all in rock and roll bands. A lot of us were artists and things like that. When it graduated to the choking and spitting and vomiting stuff, a lot of us from the old days were like, this is just not good.
Where does it go from here?
Well, short of driving a train up someone's ass, I honestly don't know. I really don't know because, and the thing is that back then, you know, people ask you, what would you want to do? How much would you like to get paid? So you would say, well, I'd like to get paid $1,000 a day regardless whether I have sex or not. Because back then, because they were cutting the movies into drive-in, it was almost like the cable version, you know, sort of back then. So we were able to charge, you know, $2,000 a day whether we were having sex or not. And it took between 2 and 3 weeks to shoot a movie. I mean, Captain Lust and all of that. I mean, this is like, they rented the replicas of the Niña, the Pinta, the Santa Maria, you know, from the...
Well, at one time, adult films had a script.
And a large script. And the better you acted, the more work you got.
Exactly, that's what I'm doing.
And there was also a plethora of beauty back then, which somehow became stamped into some goofy Barbie doll thing. But back then, I mean, you had all colors, all kinds, all shapes, all sizes of people.
And we also had, there was a big difference between the East and the West Coast because all the stuff that was shot on the East Coast was darker. I mean, you're a brunette, Vanessa's got dark hair, Samantha Fox, the whole bit. It was like, you know, New York was a pretty dangerous place back then, too, around Times Square and stuff like that, as opposed to the stuff that was shot on the West Coast with the bubbly blondes, and everything's nice, and the sun and shit, you know? So there was a big difference between the films back then. And, you know,
yeah, there was. There was what some people call the Golden Age, you know, when it moved to California, and they were still shooting film style when video had just come out. But that's when it kind of exploded, and that's when it came into a lot of... directors and producers that really weren't artistic.
Right.
They were just in it for, you know, something or another, and then the casting couches and all that kind of stuff, which I used to tell girls, you know, don't fuck for the job. That is the job, for Christ's sake. What the fuck is the matter with you?
Yeah, do that for money.
Yeah.
Well, I know when we first talked in the lineup about the show, you hadn't done one of these, and we were talking, and I said, well, you know, we like the Golden Age. And I think I told you, I said, well, we always celebrate our adult stars when women were shaped like women.
Yeah.
Meaning they had different shapes, and I just remember you letting out a laugh going, you know, I understand what you mean, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because now they're all Barbie.
It's all cookie cutter. Rio said it best. It's all cookie cutter blondes.
No,
ka-chunk,
it is.
Ka-chunk, ka-chunk, tattoo. Ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk.
But they go, and then they, you know, thanks to breast enhancements, this and that, they all look exactly the same. They all look, you know, it's like they're all made out of ticky-tack, and they all look just the same.
If I remember right.
And you know what? The fingernail thing is what really gets me. It's like the lipstick dye thing is one thing, but how do they fuck with those fingernails? I mean, my God. I don't want those fingernails inside me. I mean, you might lose one, for God's sake. It'd take forever to fish that thing out. You know? Seriously. I mean, those girls have nails this long. Are they really? Are they really into women? I don't know.
I remember there was the first...
Not with fingernails like that. I'm sorry, girls. You know what I mean.
There was a feature-length tranny film that they ran in New York that you were in. I think it was called Sulka's
Wedding. Best movie ever. great story about the set of Salka's Wedding. It's me, Ron Jeremy Salka, who was just a terrific transsexual, transgender, and I was good friends with her her doctor, and then I kind of became sort of a an aftercare apartment for a lot of the trannies that went through the operation. And but we were on the set, and we were having a great time, and we had this big picnic, you know, the wedding scene, the big picnic wedding scene, and we were shooting, this was a West Coast shot film, and you have to remember that we couldn't shoot in Los Angeles, because the motion picture industry didn't want us to, you know, make more money than they did, so they wouldn't give us permits. So we would all kind of, you know, convene somewhere, and we take PSA Airlines, which of course we nicknamed Porn Star Airlines. And we would go way up to, north of San Francisco. As an aside, we always used to fuck the receptionist at the Howard Johnson's in Novato. Lily, her name was. God bless Lily. She was just fabulous. But regardless, anyway, we were doing this movie, Salka's Wedding, and it was on a horse farm. And they had this big white a wedding cake, you know, and all the food around it. And some of it was prop food. And Ronnie will eat anything, as we all know. And the horse comes up, and somebody was fucking. I don't remember whose scene it was, but we were all, and it was probably Sulka and somebody, I don't know. And the horse, which was a stud, comes up, and just as if on cue, just fucking comes on top of the wedding cake. Just dripping with this fucking horse cum, and it's just like, it's just fabulous. It was just one of the more memorable moments of my career. You know?
The weird thing is, I got roped into seeing that in the theater because, I used to do like a fifth of tequila a night at one point back in the 70s, so I could get talked into seeing anything. And I was sitting there, I don't know what the most disturbing thing was, was either her getting fucked or Ron Jeremy sucking his own cock. I don't know what started it.
Well, you know, Ronnie, here's the funny thing about Ronnie. Ronnie and I have been friends for a long, long time. We were friends since, we met in 1975 when he was still teaching math in Brooklyn. He was a math teacher. And he wanted in the industry so bad, but for some reason, I don't know why he gave people the creeps off the bat. I don't know why. And they wouldn't hire him. And he was a relatively, you know, young, attractive man at the time. Kind of looked like a little young werewolf. If you ever seen those old pictures?
Very bad.
You know, hair and everything. He was cute. But he couldn't get hired. And there was, we used to shoot what were called loops back then, which they, you know, people would walk in and put, you know. There we go. So, on Saturday afternoons, it would be me and Jamie and Annie and Suzanne McBain and a couple people, you know, and we'd go, there were a couple people, Peter and Iris, mainly, and Leonard Kirkman. They were the two main loop shooters in the city. We'd make extra money. I mean, it was like $500 a loop. It took like maybe 40 minutes to shoot. It was like real-time sex, so we'd all just go get laid. They always had a great spread. They always had a great spread of food, so, you know, and Ronnie would be like, if no one can get it up, I'll be the stand dick. I'll be the stunt dick. And that's how he started getting hired. Because somebody drank too much the night before, and Ronnie was like, I'm ready, I'll do it. And then when everyone saw what a big dick he had, and then he could keep it up, and then he had stamina, that was the birth of his career from those loops. And then little by little, he became a star, and he quit his illustrious teaching career and became Ron Jeremy. And since then, I have to say, he's been one of the dearest, most kind, respectful, wonderful people that are dear to my heart. And always very generous with any endeavor that I worked with. Always donated money to the clinics. Just fucking sweetheart. I love him. I do.
And you got a bunch of stuff written down in front of you that's probably perfect. Yeah.
The one movie I wanted to ask you about, because I think it has a following at Wasteland especially, and it's become kind of a cult hit of its own, is the movie Water Power.
Water Power rocked. And I'll tell you why we love this movie, because number one, it was based on an actual story. Yep. Forgive me, I get weepy. I'm fucking old. I'm just like, you know, old weepy, emotional old bag. But Water Power was an original story about a man who was the end of a bandit.
Didn't Frank Zappa do a song about
that? Yes, he did. Yes, exactly.
Michael's exactly. Hammer Band.
Actually, Frank wanted to do the soundtrack for it, but I don't remember what record company he was working for. They wouldn't allow him to.
It was Verve, MGM, I think.
And they wouldn't allow him to do it because it was an adult film. But Jamie is like the perfect bandit. You know, Jamie was the dark guy. He could play the bandit like no one. And you have to remember that we all were also doing, you know, Rob Everett and John Leslie and Joey. And we were all doing summer stock. We were all doing off-Broadway. Some of us did some stuff on Broadway. Freddie Lincoln was directing stuff on Broadway. Yeah. And so we were all, it was like, horror was really kind of coming of age. And... I'll get back to that later, but you know, we were all real actors, is I think the point I'm trying to make, is that we really got into these.
Jamie was quite a good actor.
We really got into these characters, very, very much so, and we rehearsed, and we had, you know, lighting and dress rehearsals and the whole thing, and Water Power was just classic, because my girlfriend, Long Jean Silver, who I don't know if anybody remembers her.
Oh, yeah, I talked to her on Facebook. We actually talked to her. Actually, I'm in contact with her. I'm trying to get her.
Whoever amputeed her leg that made it look like a gigantic dick was like my best friend, because she was my roommate for a while, and it was just fabulous. But she was in the movie, and Marlena Willoughby. Well, and my favorite line from the movie is, because Marlena Willoughby always played like the Joan Crawford type, because she was so tall and thin. And she had that hanky with the lily, you know, and she's pushing Long Jean Silver in a wheelchair, and Long Jean Silver says, "Nurse, I'm not sure if I need an enema." And Marlene says, "Yes, you do, dear. We all do." That's like the best line in the movie, you know. But it just became so controversial. I think the only other controversial movie I did other than that was something called The Nun's Bad Habit, which has since been very buried. If anybody can ever find a copy of it, please contact me, because it was not a loop, but a short. It was about 30 minutes long, maybe 35 minutes long, and I played a nun praying over a candle, right? All the ethereal music, the whole deal, and then the candle, of course, turns into a dildo candle, which is on fire, which of course then turns into, of all people, Herschel Savage, who was like the only Jew in the industry at the time. His big circumcised dick, and he's got these gigantic wings. So I'm trying to suck his dick on an altar, and he's trying to balance these gigantic wings. It was fabulous. The thing about that movie is that it opened, they thought it was going to be like a really big hit because it was so controversial, and they opened it in Boston, and there were actually people there, was literally stones, throwing stones at us. Like BC.
Being cast out.
Yeah, like, yeah.
No, sort of like our Muslim buddies, you know?
Yeah, it was bizarre. So that made me, you know, that just made me have an appetite for doing the industry even more.
Somebody I actually wanted to ask you about, because I think there's nobody like him, especially whenever you watch his movies and you had the opportunity to work with him a couple times, was your impressions on Jerry Damiano.
Oh, Gerard Damiano. I worked with Gerard Damiano for many times. Gerard Damiano was, he was wonderful, he was gentle, but he was extraordinarily creative. His roots started out as a hairdresser, but he was one of the best directors I ever worked with. Every nuance. We had lots of rehearsals with wardrobe and lighting. Every little thing had to be just so. He didn't direct the sets, because any good director knows. If you tell someone how to suck cock, you know, I mean, that's just not a good thing to do. But he would just set everything up so perfectly where you would look so beautiful. And the great thing about it was he had such tragic shit. I mean, we all died in the end. Somebody died in the end, or, you know, I mean, and these were plots where, I mean, I remember I did a movie where Jamie played a post-traumatic stress war victim, and he killed me, and we had these big stunts, and I remember it was my first big stunt, and I had to dive into a pool which had all kinds of live lights in it, and the stunt people were like, now make sure you unhook your foot from that plug before you fall in the pool. And I was like, and you have to react to the shot, and there's a squib in you at the same time, and I was like, oh my gosh. But he was just so artistic and so wonderful and so tragic. Just the tragedy and the drama, and the Night Hunger was one of my favorite films I did with him. He was just the best. You know, he was the original. I mean, who's better than Gerard Damiano?
Nobody, actually. He was one of the best in the business.
He was the real deal.
Did you ever work any of the clubs in New York, like Show World and The Melody?
I did. My first gig was with in the Melody Burlesque, and I was privileged I never started as a go-go girl or anything. I was also a professional dancer, so I toured with the Martha Graham Dance Road Company as a modern dancer for a couple of years. And when I went to go strip, right, they said, okay, you're going to feature under this lady named Tempest Storm. I was like, oh my God. She fucked Elvis Presley, and she's got her own band. I mean, she's still having a little bit of those, and you know, all that stuff. And she did this bump and grind and this whole seductive thing. And I was like, oh shit, I don't know if I can do that, you know. And I tried, and I was really awkward. I did one show. I was her co-feature, and she said, God bless her. She said, come on, come here, kid, you know. She said, you're not really a stripper, are you? And I go, no. I'm a modern ballerina. She goes, it's okay as long as you, you know, we have this many pieces of clothing, and this is how many times, and this is, you use the music that you like. You don't have to use the music that I like. You can use modern music so long as you tease and do the art of striptease. And she actually taught me about the art of striptease. And I mean, back then, you had 21 pieces of stuff. I mean, you had a choker, you had a bra, you had pasties, you had a jock, a G-string, typically sometimes a garter belt, stockings, gloves, shoes or boots. And then when you got down to a certain point in your show, there would be what was called a prop, and you would put on what was called a duster, which was a very a large, round silk piece of material, which you had to learn how to move in certain ways. And you would do this whole, you know, part of the show. And just at the very, 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 very end, she told me, just no more than 90 seconds do you ever show your pussy, because it's all about the way you take things off. It's really not about your pussy. It's about people watching the way that you seduce them, that they come to see. And she explained to me the art of striptease. And it was quite an honor to be deflowered by Tempest Storm. I also had the privilege of working with Sally Rand, who was the originator of the fan dance. And the fan dance is where, you know, they had the big ostrich feathers, and you have one ring for each feather on, you know, and the idea is that you take off all of your clothing, but you also use the fans to disguise, you know, the feathers, pardon me, to disguise your body. So, I mean, I kind of got in right on the tail end of the real shit, and I was pleased to... you know, and the sad thing was, they both told me, you know, we really hate to see this go to the porn stars. We know that you're the next deal, and we know you're going to fucking ruin it.
Burlesque is actually making a lot of big comeback lately.
It is. It
All
is.
Over Cleveland
it
has is. Their own burlesque troupe. And
but, you know.
You mentioned a lot of girls. I used to write the dancers and had plenty of autographs in my youth because they were a dying breed. So Tempest Storm,
absolutely,
Blaze Star, and Lily St. Cyr.
Lily St. Cyr,
I have autographs from all of them.
Teresita San Juan, all those girls. I mean, they kind of really taught me how to.
I grew up with loops. You know, your dad always knew you were watching this porn because when he watched it, it went backwards. Because we were too young, we weren't about to rewind the shit. We just put it in the next one.
I rewound my shit. I wasn't going to get caught.
Hell with it. All you got is
rewind. Rewind.
For those of you who don't know, the Melody Burlesque was the Class A strip joint in Manhattan. Other than the Roxy, which you both know I got kicked out of for life. So that's, you heard that story. So I don't want to go back there. But I used to do fucked up shit. So.
I'd like to hear that story. I remember Al Cronish was managing at the place. And he said, what do you want to call yourself? I said, Chandelier. He said, Chandelier? What the fuck? He goes, that's no kind of name. He said, didn't you just do a movie under Sharon Mitchell? And I chose the name Mitchell because it was during Watergate, and I liked Martha Mitchell because she had such a big mouth, and I thought, and I was a feminist. And he said, why don't you just use the name you did movies under? He goes, that's kind of going to make sense. I was like, okay. It was really funny. I was like, okay. So that's how I started, and that was my first gig at the Melody. And then, of course, I don't think I ever did a gig at the Roxy, though.
Roxy was a shithole. Hardly anybody worked there. I mean, Showworld was usually the place people wound up.
I wound up at Showworld on the third floor. In fact, I got busted there one night. Showworld was like the epicenter of dirt. It was fabulous.
It was in Screw Magazine. It was called the cutting edge of the masturbatory arts.
Awesome. It was great. I mean, you walked in on the ground floor, and there were all the peep show girls, right? Or on the ground floor. And then if you went down, there was all the trannies, right?
Yeah.
And then I think the second floor were the boys, and the third floor was
Triple Threat Theater.
The triple treat, whatever the fuck. Anyway. Yeah. And it was porn live sex shows, and Joey Silvera used to do a tremendous amount of the live shows, and then we would come out and do S&M or whatever, and my girlfriend Ming Toy and I, we did a lot of shows up there, and I remember one time I'm on stage and I was doing like this rootin' tootin' cowboy act, and I had my cowboy boots on, and I remember I found a pair of Roy Rogers chaps at Trash and Vaudeville. And they had to be for a kid, but they fit me perfectly from here to here. So I had a bra on, I had a holsters, and I had those snap things and a whip, and I was throwing lollipops out, and I was dancing, and I had gotten down to my garter belt, my bra, and my panties, and all of a sudden I heard my DJ say, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. That'll be all. Thank you very much. And the audience started to throw shit at me. It's New York. I'm like, what the fuck? There's a pussy. They're freaking out. And I'm like going, okay, what's going on? And then I see that there's detective lining the back of the stage. And they had just, taken it. And they said, okay, you want to take a ride downtown? I said, nope. I got another show at 10 p.m. They're like, well, then you better get dressed. I'm like, yep, I'm dressed. And I go, I don't have to go anywhere. And they said, oh, no, you're arrested for obscenity and blah, 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 blah. And I said, oh, really? Now, I didn't have my panties off. So I played kind of a dirty trick, which I got in trouble for. They didn't know what sex I was. And there were a lot of trannies. They arrested everybody from the trannies all the way up, from the trannies, the fags, the peep show girls. They hauled all of us in.
That was when A. Beam was mayor, right?
Yes.
Yeah, because they made that whole deal about the sprinkler system.
Exactly.
Came down with 40 cops.
Exactly.
Came down
right.
With 40 cops to bust them for a sprinkler violation.
Yeah, and they hauled everybody away. I mean, they hauled everybody away. And my dad was a cop. So I'm like, oh, fuck, he's going to kill me. So I go in there like, okay, what's your name? And I go, I said, my name's Mitch. And they said, well, what's your sex? I said, I'm not telling you. You haven't seen what my sex is. I'm not telling you. And they said, well, we're good. So they threw me in the tranny slammer at the Tombs. And they said, sooner or later you're going to have to pee. And we're going to see just where you go. Now, little did anyone know, I can pee standing up and I can still dot the I in Mitch. So I said, fine, you know. So the trainees are teaching me how to make like blue eye makeup out of fucking matches, and I'm having a grand old time. And I have to pee, so they're waiting to see which bathroom I go in. So I go into the men's room, and I, you know, I pee in a urinal, and they still didn't know. So I go to court, and I happen to have a large birthmark. They didn't know I had a large birthmark and a penis or a pussy or a vagina or whatever. They had no, or both, or what, they had no idea. So I just was not going to have anyone call me obscene because I'm an artist and I was entertaining people. And I was just going to fuck with them as long as I could, and I was going to fight, and I was going to win. And I won the case because the cop never saw my genitals, you know. Since been involved in a couple other busts, basically defending the Free Speech Coalition and things like that with Bill Margold and so on and so forth. And I fought and won each case because my definition of obscenity is clearly not taking your clothes off, fucking, or doing anything that you have no problem doing. You know, I mean, the level of poverty and, you know, unemployment in this country right now, and, you know, the rape of the pharmaceutical companies, this to me is obscene. But me, taking my fucking drawers off, it's not going to follow me around for the rest of my life.
Well, they call us a free country, and they send your children to die in the name of it, but then what's free about hauling you in doing something that you're not hurting?
Well, wait, yeah. Well, here's the thing, you know, and they wanted to change the age of being able to work in porn. Yet you can send your kid out to take a fucking bullet, but you can't give a blowjob at 18.
Yeah, or buy a drink.
What the fuck is that?
You can't go buy yourself a drink.
That's craziness to me. But regardless, I just think that I've been privileged to be sort of in the last wave of a very artistic, erotic era. And it's just been a privilege to entertain everyone and go to school and then give back to the industry a little bit that I did for 13 years, which was nice. But I still got in the government's way. I mean, the government still has a hard-on for this industry. Don't kid yourself. They do.
Probably because of the old mob ties, too, which, you know, may have went away.
Nah, I think it's the religious right.
Yeah, they got that.
Don't never underestimate a few really loud-mouth assholes. Because
yeah, we know
they don't have
it
a life.
It only takes a couple with a bunch of dogs.
With no life. The less life you have, the more life you have to interfere with everyone else's life.
Yeah.
Oh, did you know that Vanessa sued Joel?
No, I did not.
Yeah, she, remember the water fountain? I think it was on the second
floor.
Oh,
yeah.
She slipped on it because it was leaking. And
that fucking thing had been leaking for
years.
Yeah,
I know. Well, she sprayed the rank and she went up in the elevator.
Did she?
Yeah, she went up in the elevator with DB. Remember DB?
Yeah.
Okay. And he's like, Vanessa, how can we make this go away? She goes, oh, no, I'm taking you to court. And then she's laughing and she's telling me, goes, I sued the mob and I won. What happened to DB? Yeah, Sammy
yeah.
Bolt.
Yeah, right. He's still, he's pushing daisies.
Well, he was a nice guy, though.
He was a very sweet guy.
He's coming to Liquidate. Oh, another thing, our paths actually almost crossed because Sharon used to go to Liquidators a couple times.
I got busted once for sitting on the naked on the lions outside of the New York. Yeah. Somebody dared me to do it. It was Richard Kunis, I think.
Okay. Yeah.
And he had a cable show, and he also had
that big video store.
Yeah, yeah, the video store right there. And he fucking promised me that he would have a car waiting for me if I did that. And the car waiting for me was a police car. And I was like, my pussy's freezing. I'm on this fucking ice cold fucking lion, stark naked, you know, being filmed. And I was like,
was that for a film?
He bailed me out, and I was like, Rose Guard's like, what was it? Was traffic on my ice?
You know, I could have took a cab.
I could have ran. Yeah, but the cops got me. I was just, but I was having just too much fun getting off on sitting on one of the lions in the New York Library. So, National Landmark. My pussy stage is still on there. It's all good with me.
Something I actually wanted to ask you about, because I know it was one of the first things that you have ever done, and I imagine in the adult world it's actually really difficult to do comedy, but in the film Joy, what was that like as an experience to do comedic acting as far as a porn movie goes?
That was one of my first movies, and that was a lot of rehearsal. That I had to audition for that movie twice before I got it. And I learned a lot about deadpan. One of my friends was Rodney Dangerfield at Dangerfield's, and the only reason I went to him was because he used to hire me as a laugher. Because, you know, I sat and laughed, and I got paid for it, $30 a night. And, you know, we bought cat food and cigarettes, and it was all good with me. And I went to him, and I was like, what's deadpan? What it meant. I was like, geez, that sounds terrible. And he's like, no, that means when somebody says a line, you just hold and hold and hold, 2 beats to the delivery and where to put my eyes and so on and so forth. And it was fun, you know. Everything was a learning experience. The biggest kick I got out of doing the movie Joy was they actually closed off an entire wing of Newark Airport for us to do a sex scene. And they closed off a whole section of Wall Street. And we actually shot in a subway, in an actual moving subway, and a subway graveyard. And, I mean, back then, you know, porn was art. And everybody was really interested in being involved in it, including the mayors that gave permits.
Who was Howdy Mansfield?
Fuck.
You had to pick a hard one, goddammit.
Balls of Fire. You're going to have to give me, you know, you're going to have to give me, like, probably an hour and 10 minutes.
So come back then.
Okay. Mansfield. Fuck me.
Brain twister. How about Al Goldstein? You ever run into him? Everybody ran into Al.
Well, of course. I mean, Screw Magazine. I mean, yeah. It was great. And Al was wonderful. And he was always at Plato's Retreat hanging out.
The other night we were talking when we came in, you got in late, we were having a few drinks, and we kind of gravitated right to John Holmes stories, and you haven't told a single one of them, but you told a hilarious one about, you know, him just stealing from the girls on the set.
Well, John Holmes had a
tell
penchant,
it to the audience.
Had a penchant for giving girls, the actresses, jewelry. The only problem was he stole it from one of the actresses and gave it to the other. So, which we all knew, which we all kind of caught on to after a while. But the problem with John was not so much that. It was that we used to shoot, you know, as I said, up in Novato, Northern California, in these locations, in these big mansions. And he would always pick, like, the little girls' room or the kids', you know, the boys' bunk bedrooms. And he would, huddle himself in and smoke crack for hours and hours and hours. So by the time his shoot would come up, we'd all be like, okay, let's get a posse and let's all spread out. Let's look for John and, you know, eventually we'd find him in a closet somewhere and he'd be like, what? I'm ready to go. Let's go. But he used to call everyone Dolan and he used to love women and he was very, very sweet. And I had a charm bracelet that I really, really dug, and all of a sudden it's missing. And then one of the newer girls goes, oh, look what John gave me. Isn't this lovely? And it was just like... And then it started. He would steal from one girl and then give it to the next girl. And I think I got my charm bracelet back 3.5 years later from Veronica Hart because it had been stolen from whoever they had. It just kind of made its way around, you know.